Hi there, and welcome back. I'm here with Alex, and we're going to be talking more about the Barbary sheep. So Alex, could you tell me a little bit about this specimen that we have with us today?
Yeah, so this is a male Barbary sheep, or aoudad, from the collections from 1920, so about 120 years old, roughly, depending on when it was exactly collected, from somewhere in North Africa, from its native range. Obviously, the first thing you notice about it are these absolutely magnificent horns that it has. Yeah, huge. So it's a sexually dimorphic species. The males have significantly larger horns than the females, so these are mostly like a symbol of fitness, you know, showing the sexual fitness of the male, but then also potentially, I think they're used as a sort of thermoregulation, so they can use them to help keep themselves cool. So you can see it's also got this like ridged pattern, which probably increases the surface area, maybe helps with sort of heat transfer in the environment. Okay. So they live in sort of the arid mountains of North Africa, so they're like very, very, very well adapted to these sort of arid, mountainous environments. They really thrive there.
Yeah. And I mean, is this another one over here, or is this something different?
Yeah, so if you look over here, what we've got on the surface looks quite similar. So this is actually a bighorn sheep. So this is from North America. And it's also got these huge horns, sort of superficially quite similar. So the reason we've got both of these out here today is, so the aoudad, as I said, is originally from North Africa, but is introduced, there's multiple introduced populations around the world, including in the United States. So in the States, there's populations in California, New Mexico, and in West Texas, where they potentially could be a threat to the native bighorn sheep, which we have here. So you can see they're quite similar. They fill a sort of similar ecological role in the ecosystem. So there's potential for competition between them. And as I said earlier, the aoudad is very well adapted for sort of arid mountainous environments. So it does very well in West Texas. It has quite a fast reproduction rate, faster than the bighorn. So they can have two calves in every sort of year, as opposed to the bighorn sheep, which has one per female. So yeah, they reproduce very well, well adapted for the environment, and now there's more of them in West Texas than there are of the native bighorn. And so there's potential for issues there, not just from direct competition, but also from disease transmission. So they there are diseases like blue tongue or pneumonia. There's a prion disease called scrapie, which the aoudad can carry, and there's not necessarily lots of evidence for direct impact on bighorn at the moment, but there's scientists worry about the potential.
I guess that's, you know, the higher the population, the greater the risk is going to become.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, is there anything that can be done to, you know, support the bighorn sheep?
Yeah, so there is population control done of the aoudad, I believe. Going out and just controlling the numbers, making sure they don't get too high. The issue is, so the reason that the aoudad was originally introduced to the States and to other areas is basically as a big game hunting species. From private collections as well, but also just introduced as a species for hunting. So it's still an economically valuable resource. So, you know, landowners can charge fairly large sums of money for people to go out and hunt an aoudad. So it, although it can be controlled to make sure the numbers don't get too high in terms of sort of removing them completely, that's sort of probably politically not really viable, because they're a significant resource to the people in these places. So yeah, a bit of a tension there between making sure the aoudad numbers don't threaten the bighorns too much, but probably not really politically viable to remove them completely from some of these areas that they're introduced to.
Yeah, and from what I understand, however, while they're doing quite well in the United States and Croatia and elsewhere, they're not actually doing that well back in North Africa, where they originally come from.
Yeah, so the irony kind of is that although, parts of the world they're sort of thriving, in their native range, which, Morocco, Algeria, Tunisia, in all the way across to Egypt, they're actually listed as vulnerable by the IUCN. So their range there is highly fragmented. They're threatened by poaching and also by habitat loss. So they have these, there are lots of sort of small pockets of population, some of which are probably not viable, and there's not much population exchange between them.
I mean, is there any way that if we, you know, clamp down on hunting its native range, is there a possibility that that will help it recover?
Yeah, so they're perfectly adapted for these sort of arid, mountainous, desert environments. So, and they generalists, they can survive for a long time without water if they've got if they can, they can get a lot of the moisture they need just from the vegetation. Okay. They have a high reproduction rate. So yeah, if the conditions are right, they can really bounce back and have, you know, they can come from like low levels to high populations again relatively quick. Relatively short time period. So yeah, given the right circumstances, I'm sure they could bounce back. Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. Well, I think that's all we've got time for today, unfortunately. But thank you, Alex, for talking to me and to everyone at home. I hope you found that video as fascinating as I did. Why not let us know what you thought down in the comments below? In the meantime, why not like and share this video and subscribe for more content from the Natural History Museum?